I have taken not all shlokas, but some of them to highlight the points which I thought were interesting, and I think it'll be interesting for our audience, everybody who's participating in the satsang as well. So the first thing, Ram says that it is very important for any leader to have the right kind of team. It is important for any prime minister to have the right kind of cabinet ministers, to have the right kind of officers, because by himself, a king is not going to be expert in everything. So what he says is, mantro vijaya moolam hi rajnyam bhavati. Right decision making, right kind of discussion and decision making is pivotal to king success. And where can this come from? Where can this kind of right decision making come from? If he gets the right advice from people closest to him, which are the ministers that he has appointed. Now that means appointing the right ministers is very, very important. So what kind of ministers should be appointed? So Ram gives some qualities in different shlokas. What he says, Atmasama, Shuraha, Shrutvanto, Jitendriya, Kulinaha, Angi, Ingitam Jnaha, Upadhatitaha, Shuchayaha. So Atmasama, whoever you appoint must be as capable as you. Look out for people who are smart, look out for people who are intelligent. Do not look out only for somebody because you like somebody. Do not look out for somebody just because they are saying good things to you. They have to be capable, they have to be brave. Shrutvanto, they have to be well learned, they must be experts in their field. Jitendriya, they should have self-control. Why is it important to have self-control? Otherwise, it's very easy to honey trap people, those who don't have self-control. People who are do not have self-control are very corruptible. They can become corruptible. Not that they are, but it is possible. It is possible for them to give in to gratifications undesired of a minister and maybe give out state secrets. Who knows? So very important to have Jitendriya. Kulinaha, coming from good family. Now, coming from good family could also mean who come with right kind of references, who come with right kind of past experience and past reputation. That is important. Upadhatitaha, upadhatitaha, one who are incorruptible, who do not give in to bribery, who do not give in to corruption. Shuchayaha, one who are full of integrity, people who can be trusted, people who are true. So, and before that, he also says, mantra dharehi amatyehi. Mantra dharehi is people who are trustworthy. Why they are trustworthy? Because they can keep a secret. That is extremely important for ministers, to be able to keep a secret, to be able to keep decisions to themselves, people who can keep things in confidence. So these are the important qualities that one must look out for in a minister. And we have appointed ministers now. We have appointed right kind of experts. We have appointed right kind of officers. But then how should decision making happen? Ram says, mantrayasya na ekaihi na bahubhi sah. You shouldn't take a decision in isolation just with one person. Talk to one person, consult, get done. Nor should you take a decision talking to everybody and anybody. Typically, 3 to 4 persons should be involved. This is said in some other sarga, but he basically says that it is important for a king to understand how many people are real stakeholders and involve them accordingly. Do not discuss with too many people, because then there is, you'll have too many noises in your discussion. You may not be able to keep that decision secret. Hence, it is important to not discuss with too many people, and also important to not discuss just with one people or without anybody, because then you don't get diversity of views. You might get a view which is probably biased, and that might not be good for the decision you take. So having the involving the right people while taking those decisions is important. And what is also more important, that the decision should not be leaked before it should be, before the consent is given. Now you see, all these are as important for a minister, for a prime minister, for a king in administration, as well as in any kind of organization, for a CEO. And the part about not leaking is even more important, as we have these stock markets and share trading and things like that. We know there could be issues related to people could actually lead to some kinds of deceit. If a decision of the company is already known, people can play around with the share prices and stuff. It could make your competitors aware, which could then have a negative impact on your own company. So all these points which Ram talks about ministers and approach to decision making are valid in any organization as well. Now here I have written just points, but the way Ram asks is in question format. So he says, kashchit atma sama mantrihi kruta krutaste, have you appointed the right kind of people? So he's asking, like you see in the last one, kashchit mantra sena eka, are you not only discussing with one only? Na, he's asking, and are you not discussing with too many people? Is it that your mantra, is it that your discussion, the decision that you take, I hope it is not being leaked out. Rashtram na paridhavati. So he's asking questions. He's not giving a sermon, but he's teaching rules of administration. He's giving tips of administration through his questions. The other part is about justice delivery. Now, one of the main tasks of a king, of an administrator, of judiciary, is to ensure that justice is delivered in a transparent fashion, and the institution itself, the judiciary institution itself, people have trust in that institution. People trust the decisions. I think that is very, very important for peace and law enforcement in a country, in any state, even in an organization. So what is important? Ram says, yatharth danda. A king has to know what is yatharth danda. He says, ugrena dandena brusham udvejitam praja. If a king gives very strict punishment, then it will agitate the citizens. A punishment has to be commensurate with the crime done. It shouldn't be too aggressive so as to agitate and oppress the citizens. It shouldn't be too soft so that people do not regard the king at all, and it does not desist them from committing the crime. It shouldn't be mrudu, it shouldn't be too ugra. And this is the same thing which even Chanakya talks about in Arthashastra. Actually, yatharth danda is a shabda, is the word which Chanakya uses in Arthashastra. He says, yatharth danda hi pujyate. Yatharth danda is only respected. Ugra danda udvejite. Ugra danda agitates. Mrudu danda paribhuyate. If the danda is mrudu, nobody will care for it. Nobody will regard it. Hence, commensurate, apt punishment needs to be given. What more? Ram talks about equality before law, equality before government. He says, vyasane kashchit adhasya durgatasya cha. Adhyasya is somebody who is very rich. Durgata is somebody who is poor. Adhya is somebody very rich. So when, be it poor, be it rich, if anybody is in distress, how should that case be dealt with? Viragaha. Amatyaha viragaha paschanti. Your ministers should consider any case, be it of a very rich person, be it of a poor person, anybody is in distress, every case should be considered dispassionately and objectively. Aisa nahi hona chahiye ki, you know, somebody comes from a very good family and hence he gets away doing a crime, or he gets more preference if he has a problem to solve his problem, he gets more preference just because the person comes from a rich family or comes from a known family or has connections. Whereas the person who is poor, does not have connections, his work never gets done. Ram says that should not happen. You have to be very careful that your ministers do not have any kind of bias in dealing with different kinds of citizens. They should treat every citizen equally. Then he goes on to say, for delivering justice, it is very important to follow due process. Just because somebody is accused doesn't mean that he should be punished. A person must be punished only after proper inquiry involving the right kind of experts. Shastra kushalaihi aprushta, shastra kushalaihi, only after right kind of inquiry. Aprushta is investigation, having discussed, asked. Shastra kushalaihi, people who are learned in the kind of scriptures, in dharma shastra, in, you know, arthashastra, whoever is involved, they must be consulted. Right kind of investigation should happen, and only then an accused should be punished. And he also says that when a guilt is proven, when a thief is caught red-handed, when there are all proofs, in that case, a thief should not be let go. If somebody has connections, or if somebody can give a bribe, in that situation, if he's caught red-handed, he must be punished. He shouldn't be let go. Lobhat, dhana lobhat, he shouldn't be let go. Na muchyate choro dhana lobhat. Just out of greed, a person whose guilt is proven should not be let go. Now you see, a king by himself cannot do all this. He has to rely on his ministers to deliver justice. He has to rely on his officers to implement some of these policies. And then hence we go back to the previous point on the importance of appointing the right kind of ministers, on importance of having the right kind of qualities in a ministers. So what it is very important for a Raja, administrator, leader to have the right kind of team and appointing the right kind of person to do right kind of activity. The next part is about economics, taxation, wages, welfare. So, you know, there is nowadays there is a thing that any entrepreneur is looked suspiciously. Any entrepreneur by default is considered to be corrupt. But we have to understand that entrepreneurs are actually resource generators. They create wealth. They are wealth creators. They create employment. And it is only through these wealth creators that a state can be prosperous. And only when a state is prosperous can there be some kind of dharma. So you know, in Arthashastra, Chanakya tells us that dharmasya moolam artha, arthasya moolam rajya, dharmasya moolam artha. In Gujarati we say papi pet bhajan, khali pet bhajan na hai. If you are hungry, you cannot do any kind of bhajan. You cannot engage yourself in virtuous activity if you are hungry. So the first step is to ensure there is right wealth and there is prosperity with the people. People are satisfied. The basic needs of the people are fulfilled. That is created by these resource generators. That is created by people who are engaged in this economic activities. So Ram specifically asks, Daita sarve krushi go raksha jivanaha. Vartayam sanshritaha tata lokehi sukhamedhate. Varta is basically economics. Varta is trade. Varta is resource generation. Ram says, he asks Bharat that you are taking care of these people, of your farmers, of cattle rearers, everybody who's involved in trade. You are taking care of all of them now. Why? Because those who are involved in these kind of activities, in resource generation, it is these kind of people who create wealth, lokehi sukhamedhate. These kind of people lead to happiness and wealth in the society. So it's very important to take care of them. Then going on, he also talks about managing finances. Again, very simple, which everybody in the organization knows, everybody in the country knows. He says, Ayaste vipulha kaschit alpatara vyaya. Your income has to be more than what you spend. Well, which basically he's saying that there shouldn't be any deficit financing. Yeah, so it was a different time. Maybe deficit financing has its own pros now. But what he's essentially saying is that a king should have complete view, complete insight into his treasury. He should be well aware of what is his income. He should be well aware of where the expenditures are happening. And both expenditure and income have to be commensurate to each other. That is extremely important. Then he makes one more point. He says, apatreshu nahate kaschit kosho gachati raghavaha. He says, you are sure, Bharat, that you are not giving any patronage, any wealth to the undeserving. All your welfare schemes, are you sure your welfare schemes are reaching only to the people who are needy? They are not filling the kosho, the coffers of those who are not deserving. You know, there was all the welfare scheme that used to happen in India in the 1990s, Rajiv Gandhi had said that of the 1 rupee that really goes, probably 5 paisa actually reach the people who deserve it. The rest, 90-95 paisa, are wasted. So Ram actually is aware that this can happen, and he's making Bharat cautious about it. And he's saying he's not. So see, he could have said it in one way. He could have said, are you sure that you are giving money to the deserving? Instead, he's asking, are you sure that you are not giving money to the undeserving? You are sure that there is no leakage in your welfare delivery? That is more important. And related to this, one point comes to my mind. This is from Mahabharata, from Shanti Parva, when Bhishma is on the bed of arrows. And Yudhishthir goes to him to ask about Rajdharma. And one of the things that Bhishma mentions, he talks about when is a wealth wasted, when is a daan wasted. And Bhishma says, wastage of wealth happens in two ways, by not giving to the deserving and by giving to the undeserving. Because one who doesn't deserve it gets it and there is no use of that wealth. That's completely wasted. And somebody who needs it doesn't get it. That is also a wastage of wealth. So the point which Ram makes here is ensure that you do not give patronage to one who is not deserving. As we see, applicable to our administration as well. He makes one another very interesting point. He speaks about paying wages on time. So when he talks about paying wages, he includes everybody, the workers, as well as people in the army, people, the soldiers in the army. And first he asks that, you know, are you sure you're paying the wages to on time and apt to all your workers and your soldiers? And then he makes a comment. He says, why is it important to pay wages on time? Ram says, kalati kramanat chaiva bhakta vetanyoho bhrutaha bhartuhu kupyanti dushyanti so anatha sumahan. If the wages are not paid on time, the workers will become very hostile. They will become corrupt. They will resort to activities to gain their wages if they are not paid on time. And if resort to deceitful activities if the wages are not paid on time. And once the workers become hostile, once they start working in a way which is not in interest of the employer or of the king or the government, whatever, then great calamity befalls on the employer. Obviously, if you're, you know, however big the organization is, eventually it is all the employees who lead to the wealth or success of the organization. But if they do not receive their due, obviously there is no incentive for them to work. If they do not work, it is not going to be in the interest of the company. Or if they work against the interest of the company, then obviously the company is sure to fail. So paying wages on time is also very, very important. Sorry, I can't. One sec, I'll share again. I was not able to go into the next slide.
It's okay, take your time.
So till now, he spoke about the different activities that a king should undertake in appointing right kind of ministers, ensuring right kind of judiciary justice mechanism, ensuring welfare of whoever are the resource generators. Of course, he talks about a lot of things. He talks about welfare and suraksha, of protection of women. He talks about taking care of all your vruddha, bal, all of that. So all that is there. I have only picked out the most important ones or the ones which I thought were interesting to discuss. Yeah. And after that, then Ram also talks about the king himself. Of course, the work is done by the ministers, but it is very important that the king himself is disciplined. So Ram says, and in fact, this shloka that I'm going to read out now, it is in the very beginning of this sarga. Yeah, I think it's already the fifth or sixth shloka. It's in the very beginning itself. He starts off with the discipline of the king. So what Ram says, kashchit nidra vasham na aishi, kashchit kale avabhudase. So he's asking Bharat that it is not that you are sleeping too much. And is it that you're waking up on time? So sleeping and waking up discipline is extremely important for the king. He cannot sleep as long as he wants. He cannot sleep late into the morning. He has to wake up early. He has to not become nidra vasha. He cannot be controlled by nidra. The nidra has to be limited because, you know, deep sleep is important, but sleep also takes your time. So managing that discipline of waking up and sleep is very, very important. And also what Ram says is, what should you do when you wake up? He says, kashchit apara ratreshu chintayasya arthanaipunam. Apara ratreshu, which is in the last part of the night. Last part of the night is before the sun rises. Yeah, before the sun rises. So if we say, assume 6 o'clock is the sunrise, he says the king should wake up by like 3 o'clock or so, spend some time to get ready, and then spend the last part of the night. So maybe say 4 to 6, that part should be spent thinking about arthanaipunyam. He should think about statecraft and administration. He should plan his day before actually the sun rises and he gets on with his activities. And it's very interesting that in Arthashastra, Chanakya has actually also given a timetable for the king. And what Chanakya says is that in this part, just before the sun rises, in the very early part of the morning or the very last part of the night, a king should think about all the guptachara of, you know, all the spy related work and the statecraft. So statecraft and spy related work should be taken care of at that time because nobody else is up at that time. So you have, your mind is fresh. There is nobody around you and you can carry on with some of these very confidential activities in that time of the day. So Ram gives a similar tip to Bharat as well. The one other thing which Ram mentioned, and it's important, it is the accessibility of the king. A king, the people of the state need to feel that the king is accessible to them. The employees and the customers need to feel that the company is accessible to them. The CEO of the company is accessible to them. One, it is important for the morale of the employees, morale of the citizens. But second, it is very important for the king to get first-hand information of what is going on his state. He needs to have his ear on the ground. And that can only be possible when he is also in touch with his citizens, when he is accessible to his citizens. So Ram says, Kaschit darshayase nityam manushyanam vibhushitam uttatayoho uttaya purva ahane rajputra mahapathe. So the suggestion that Ram gives is that in the morning, in the early morning, you should actually dress up and present yourself on the royal highway so that the people can see you. They can approach you if they need to be. Most importantly, you should present yourself to the people. The people should know that you are there. You are up on your toes. You're working for them. So that is very important. Accessibility, both for the king to gain information and for the citizens to have to feel that, you know, they are being heard. They are being taken care of. They are seen. So accessibility is another important point that Ram mentions. Then at the end, Sriram lists out 14 vices, 14 doshas that a king has to be careful of, or a king should avoid in every way. Of course, he talks about anruta, so falsehood. He talks about anger, about laziness and all of that. But some interesting ones I thought would be good to list it out here. So he says gratification of the five senses. Basically, he's saying that a king also has to be jitendriya. Jitendriya, jitaha indriya, have complete control over his five senses. Yeah. Now, we saw that in ministers, but it is even more important in a king to have control over his five senses, which is sight, smell, taste, sound, and touch. Yeah. So why is that important? Again, in Arthashastra, Chanakya tells us, dharmasya mulam artha, arthasya mulam rajya, rajyasya mulam indriya nigraha. Only when a king is in complete control of himself, can he become objective, can he become just, and he can actually be a good administrator, implementing all these policies, implementing all these virtues, and lead by example. When he has complete control over himself, complete control over his own desires and his own lusts. So very important to have a Jitendriya king, true for the leaders as well, true for organizations as well, true in our life in general. Then he says planning alone. So one should not plan alone in isolation. We had seen this before as well. And Ram talks about it once again. Don't just do something by yourself. Involve the right people, involve the stakeholders, and then take a proper decision. He also says that you have to consult the right people, but what is also important is to not consult people who do not have expertise and are involved in worthless acts. There might be people around the leader who are always flattering him. They don't have any kind of gist, they don't have any kind of essence, but they are there just to flatter the king, to get their work done. So Ram says, be careful of such people also, and do not consult with people who are involved in acts which mean nothing. So watch out for that as well. Failure to implement decision. Now, it is one thing to take a good decision and it is another to actually implement it. So just taking decision is not important. It has to get done. It has to reach the last mile. It has to go to the people it is desired to impact. And hence, failure to implement decision is a big dosh that a king has to be careful of and has to ensure that whatever decisions are taken get implemented. He has to have the people who can implement the decision, who can actually do the work, execute the tasks undertaken. Inability to keep a council secret. A king shouldn't be one of those loud mouths who goes around boasting about what they have done, boasting about himself, boasting about decisions, nor should he have that kind of people. A king has to have the capability to keep anything good, to keep a secret, to keep things in confidence and not tell it to anybody, not even his wife, not even his son, not even anybody closest to him. Be it king, be it leader, true for anybody who leads the organization. And lastly, Ram also talks about not opening many battlefronts at the same time. A king, a leader, a minister, a prime minister, and us as individuals, we need to prioritize our battles. We need to prioritize what matters most to us. And according to the priorities, we should undertake our actions. It is important to not open battlefronts with everybody, be it your neighbors, internal, external, to be very careful about, to assess properly what are the resources available, to do a proper strength and weakness analysis, the SWOT analysis that we talk about in the business terms. It's the same thing that is required in administration as well. It is the same thing required for a king as well. To know well strength and weaknesses of his own, of his enemies, to know very well what are the priorities of the kingdom, of himself as well as citizens, and according to that, pick tasks that are going to be most beneficial and can be done and doable. So that's the other thing which Ram says, that a king shouldn't become over enthusiastic and bat open many battlefronts. So another wise that a king should look out for. So I think this is all I have right now, but I would really encourage everybody to definitely read the chapter 100 of Ayodhya Kanda. It is actually a chapter which gives the best insights into leadership for the king, for the administrator, as well as for all of us. So with this, I will end my talk. Thank you so much. I hope I was able to bring some insight into this part of Ramayana, which is not always spoken about. So, dhanyavaad. Jai Shri Ram.
Jai Shri Ram. Thanks, Amitji, for the wonderful Pravachana and Ramayana. So, we learn.